this is supposed to be a professional organization, the very best. And for lack of a better way to say it, we had high hopes. And when this situation sort of trickled down, and the next thing you know, all that space was just sitting there, I ran an ad in the paper. Furnished rooms for rent, $600 a month, no credit check, no deposit. Because over here, you know, in California, one bedroom can cost you $1,700 easily. And they ain't taking no sort. Meaning you got to not just have a first month's rent, last month's rent, but deposit as well. And so that's a lot of money. It only cost, when I first came to California, only $300, $350 a month. It's ridiculous. And there was many people who, for lack of a better way to put it, needed renting space, and quite naturally, the place filled up quite quickly. And it ran well for 2 years. The building was costing me $2,000 a month, but I was making $3,500, able to take $1,500, put to the pocket, and plus, Lakeisha and I were living quite well. Next thing I know, after 2 years, the city of Vallejo comes up in the place and runs an inspection, saying that I have certain health and safety violations on the premises, asking that I ask my tenants to leave, at which time the property owner would have to send a work crew in to fix and address the health and safety violations. And when they were fixed and addressed properly and inspected by the city, then and only then could I allow my tenants to come back. So, without question, rather than lose the building or be fined and, you know, in any way, you know, break the law, because again, I was on parole and in no way did I want to violate. Well, I did what they say. I went to all the tenants and told them that they had to leave and that I really didn't want them to leave, but I had to ask them to leave just long enough to get the stuff fixed and told them that they could come back. Two tenants out of all the tenants were, you know, irate. One was a 36-year-old Caucasian male by the name of Arthur Becker, who was a homosexual dying from AIDS. Now watch this. And the other was a 72-year-old Caucasian female named Helen Lee. Now, the tenants that ended up in here, watch this, y'all, were quite interesting. One was dying from AIDS. The other was a very old lady. The other was a couple who was young, and the woman was pregnant because, again, I was being monitored to see and watch my behavior. They wanted to see if, indeed, I was honorable in my dealings because they had high hope to one day offer me a situation, to which they did, in a place called Walnut Creek and or Concord, California, on which I was made stand and, you know, barefoot. You know, it's a number combination that you move your feet and next thing you know, you're constantly creating the square and you step down and you step on things that cut your feet and it's real hot on the ground and yeah, and it's barbaric. And so much that while they was trying to initiate me, my feet ended up extremely burned and or cut. And I didn't like it at all because they humiliated me. Now, and during the course of this, whatever they wanted to call it, my wife at that time was working for a prominent dentist in a place called Walnut Creek. Now, we are the Creek Nation. And there's a reason why that place is called Walnut Creek. And let me tell you something else, is they are making it like Rodeo Drive. You have stores like, you know, Saxon Avenue, Tiffany's, and all of the top, you know, where a handkerchief costs, you know, $175 easily. And all you see is Rolls Royces, Mercedes, Lamborghinis, etc. Now, and it's in Concord, which is like we have already conquered them. Why? Because we put up, you know, a wall to keep the nuts out who are from the Creek Nation, Yamasi Tribe. And at this place, there's also a place called Mount Diablo, from which they omit a frequency by a computer software called PAN. Like I said, used to be a time when you get a cell phone, you'd have to give your firstborn credit check, the whole nine. Then they came out with the Talk Forever plan. Well, why would these demons give away all that money unless they were purchasing something? Well, let me tell you what they was purchasing. Unadulterated, pure mind control. And listen, that right in your environment, they have the ability to use from computer terminal to satellite dish right down into your Meisner field where they can say, jump like a chicken and then press enter and you will jump and go cock-a-doodle-doo. And then they say, you will not remember anything and press enter and you won't remember nothing. The fact that you jumped up or crowed. Now, and it was being omitted from a place called Mount Diablo. Now, I'm going to get to it, but if we're going to walk, we're not going to run. Because that's the only way y'all going to understand any of this. Because they are well structured. in a way by which, yeah, ain't no such thing as coincidence. And if anybody thinks that, you know, any of this is fabricated, they just don't have no sense. Because if you listen to me, you'll see that this is just too, you know, all the dots connect in a real way, right back to Baba. Of which, check this out, I got right now on CD-ROM this, right, a recorded conversation of a being who sounds identical to my wife, but is not. Because it was using a particular type of voice modulating software that, because it was being recorded, while I was, you know, actually talking, without question, in every way, I thought it was her, and she's saying her name is Samantha. I'm saying, well, why do you sound identical to my wife? And if these softwares can be purchased, you talk in them, and basically what the deal is, you can record somebody else's voice, and they can make you sound just like that voice. But because it was recorded, when you listen to it, it's, you know, fades in and out. When you hear Lakeisha, then you hear the man. You hear Lakeisha, then you hear the man. And one of the things that was brought up was, you should have known by being attached to Dr. York that these types of situations would occur right on the recording that will be used as an evidence in my possession right now. Yeah, that's just one thing amongst many. And in fact, so much that if I don't walk slow, and you know, some of it, I might even forget I got. Why? Because I got a trunk in here full of stuff. Listen, which makes it sort of hard to run anywhere, too, because if they come, put me out of where of this little hotel room, which the Ozo Ice and the beautiful fat, you know, brothers and sisters who are supporting us, who are, not, you know, small in number, if they were to put me out, all that stuff we would lose, meaning all the evidence, along with some things concerning secured parties, you know, and sovereignty that you all don't got, that was given to me straight by Baba. I'm talking about, I got a packet in there that's over 800 and something pages, extremely, you all know how Baba do his thing. And let me tell you how I got. I was in the penitentiary, and a brother walked up to me that I didn't even know and said, yo, your father told me to give this to you. And when I looked at it, I recognized Baba's signature the same way you all should be able to, even though his name wasn't signed to it. But the way it's structured, anybody can tell. And or if not, man, it don't matter. The information is still very, very hot. Information that I have never seen before. And I studied everything right with certain members of the Morris Science Temple. In fact, Baba had Rachel call me because I had a cousin whose name was Bruce Mobley, who had declared his sovereignty in Atlantic City, who mysteriously, check this out, died right before he's going to give me, you know, the stuff that Baba needs. Baba was asking for now, documents and Mahfouz knows all about. Seriously died from, check this out, an asthma attack. How many of y'all know people die from an asthma attack, y'all? Check this out. I talked to him today. Tomorrow, we pulled the hook up. I call tomorrow, his phone rings and rings and rings and rings. A day go by, I call again, it's still ringing. After a while, I got worried and called his mother, my aunt. My Aunt Mary answered the phone and said, hey, how you doing, Mom? I'm like, hey, Aunt Mary, how you doing? So I'm fine. I say, have you seen Barry? She said, no, I've seen him a little while. I said, well, I'm worried about it. You know, maybe y'all can go over and check on him. About 2 hours later, my aunt called me and she said, my boy is dead. He's laying in there on the floor dead, Mom. See, this here, you know, stuff like that, I done been through. And yeah, they killed him too. You not knowing? Because that's what the Knights of Templar do, alchemically, okay? And good old Lakeisha Lewis, well, let me tell you something, here it is. When the inspection was ran and these two tenants of mine, basically what they did is they, you know, they was irate and didn't want to go. I'm like, look, it ain't nothing I can do. Arthur Becker surrenders his key, and unbeknowingly to me and Lakeisha, he then doubles back, embracing me and her, you know, dwelling. You know, stealing a bunch of crap, miscellaneous, you know, CD player, DVD player. But he steals a wedding ring that was worn by, check this out, her grandmother, who in this life, whose name is Nana. See, her grandfather in that life reincarnated in this life, becoming her grandmother. My grandfather in that life reincarnated in this life, becoming my grandmother. Of course, Tohuti became known as her niece, and my grandmother in this life is named Hermine. Come on, is it coincidental? I don't think so. Now, then, okay, like I said, steals Patrice's wedding ring. She loses her mind, goes downstairs, calls the police, you know, puts out a warrant for the boy's arrest. Understandable. But here's where she messed up, supposedly. She, in a fit of rage, pays my partner who owns the barbershop to change the locks on the front door without notifying me, without notifying the property or the management office, without notifying the property owner. and also failing to give my last tenant the key. And as a result, what happens? Well, the old lady comes back the next day. She can't get in. So what does she do? She calls the police. Calls the police and says, my lady rents me a room here, and the city is asking everybody to leave. Why? Because he didn't have the legal right to rent to me in the first place. Understandable that she might think that way because she had never seen my lease. Then goes on to say, and look at this here. He unchained the locks on the door. And meanwhile, my medication is inside, along with my belongings, all to keep me from off the premise. So what do the police do? They arrest me. And guess what they charge me? Grand theft from an elder, saying that every time she paid her rent, I grand theft. Never asking to see a copy of my lease. And mind you, the chief of police was the one that came out to arrest me. How many got a chief of police? I don't know. I'll tell y'all in a minute. Watch this. Okay. Chief of police comes out to arrest me, charges me with grand theft from an elderly and elderly abuse. Why? Because I changed the locks on the door, and in doing so, with the lady's medication being on the inside, I abused her. And in that, you're going to jail, is what I was told. While Lakeisha was standing right there, watching it all, faking as if she was crying and very upset. Now, I get to county jail and face those two charges. I go to a preliminary hearing, at which time I present my lease to the judge. And now, because I'm on parole, I got to go in front of the California Board of Prison Hearing and or Commission. They call it the BPT, Board of Prison Terms. That's what it's called. So I'm in San Quentin, and I am charged with the same two charges, grand theft from an elderly and elderly abuse. Now, at this time, I go to a hearing. I sit in front of a commissioner, and in defense of the grand theft, I present the lease, the grand theft, to Smith. In defense of the elderly abuse charge, Lakeisha then testified. And this day, she was sitting there with a black eye, and I didn't know how I got there. But I soon came to find out, because there's a place that is where all the high-ranking Freemasons attend. That's a bar called My Office. Listen, and supposedly, she went in there, according to what the bar owner said, and him and his wife, and got caught stealing money off the bar. And as a result, the cook, who's a 250-pound brother, was told to put her out and whips her in a serious sort of type of way. At which time, the Vallejo City Police Department come, and who do they arrest? Lakeisha. Now, I'm saying, for what? Because if I get, okay, if this one's stealing money off the bar, but this one beats her up like that, that's a little excessive. He's going to jail, too. Why? Because he's black, and she's a woman. I mean, right. Brothers, you know, gonna beat up a woman and don't go nowhere. Yeah, okay, what I'm doing is I'm getting ready to show you all something. Long story short, which cannot be made. So it's not the type of situation where you run through this. Dude, that's how and why they're able to implement the cold twist. Because anybody who comes across their real get down and has the ability, check this out, to let it be known, they know that it's quite extensive. They know that the things that are going to be being said are quite abstract. And they know that it's, you know, they hope that it's impossible to prove this. So what are they? Do they either kill that person or lock that person away? Well, check this out. They ain't killing me, hopefully. And I can prove it because I got documents, pictures, tapes, yo, names. Yeah. That directly, all, like I said, all the dots lead right back to Baba. Because keep in mind, that place, I had a business license to open up Holy Tabernacle Ministry bookstore. And I taught class there. Okay, now. And it was right next door to a old Masonic lodge that is owned by two very wealthy 33-degree Freemasons who live in Oklahoma, which is where that lodge located, the one that did the do to Baba on May 8th. You didn't know? 2002. Y'all remember that day, right? Now, so, and the story goes on. And, you know, if y'all want me to jump over spots, I'm going to say no, I'll stop and won't say no more. But if you want to hear the rest of it, it's cool. But if you want to ask some questions, go ahead on, call in. I'll answer them however y'all want to work it, just so long as you get what you need, so that you know that this ain't, you know, bull. Yeah, and I'm not going to say that word because you can't cuss on the radio. You see?
You want to give out some sort of an address, if you had one, in case people wanted to contact.
Well, here's what it is, y'all. I'm going to be quite frank with you. If indeed some support is not rendered, not only in the capacity by which we established the committee to do what we got to do in terms of all this, because keep in mind, don't forget, that right before this became an issue, like in other words, right after the Oso Ice came onto the internet, Oso Nicely, presenting all this information, right after that, out the clear blue, here come Montel Williams talking to the entire nation about Barber's case once again. Derogatory, you know, as if Barber was as crazy can be, and nobody in America should listen to such a nut. You all saw the show, and many of us emailed in and said this nation should have opportunity to say our part. Were we afforded it? No, I don't think so. Why? Because there is nobody, you see, other than those who run the, you know, CBS, NBC, ABC, who are, you know, the very same chumps that put Bob away, who will have the authority to sanction something like that, and they are not going to let us do it. Never will you be able to tell the truth about a situation about a being such as, you know, as powerful and, you know, feared as, you know, Bob. You got to be kidding me now. Don't believe me, I don't care. But like I said, y'all all are about to find out anyway. And the proof is in the pudding. How many emails do you think the Montel Williams show received? There's a lot of us, man, all over the country that didn't like the fact that Montel Williams went on there, you know, again, character assassinating, listen, our spiritual leader and guide, and, you know, our father and loved one and brother, you know, that's our family. We ain't like it. No, and not one thing happened. Why? Because this situation was created by the elders, and it only has what that will have the ability to bring Bob's, listen, case back into the nation's eyes, the public's eyes, but this time with information that connects the entire Masonic community as being the culprit of having done not just me, but Bob too. Now, again, if y'all want me to tell the whole story, I don't have no problem. Because again, like I said, I go slow. I'm getting old. I can't run no more. My legs is wobbling. I will not be able to escape the oncoming death that these beings have in store for me, because I'm watching them as they watch me, and the walls are closing in around me. I know where they launder their money. It is an antique store that the average table costs 10 grand. And let me tell you something, they ain't sold not one piece of furniture in that place since it's been open. Why? Because the neighborhood is in, the people don't got money like that. And yeah, what are they doing? Well, let me explain, they're getting money from the adult pornography, doing child pornography. The money from the adult pornography supports the making of the child pornography that is sold on dummy websites all over the world. And they set up these forums where you have these child molestation orgies that, for a very, very expensive price, you and your perverted, demented, you know, Illuminati self can attend. Now, see, again, I'm going to say this to the entire family. The reason last night I didn't even bother answering the Niecy Nash question is because it was already answered two nights before and addressed, and because of the brother's tone. His tones reflected, I'm tone sensitive, his tones reflected venom and hostility, you know? And I don't care what nobody say, if anybody has read any of the posts that has been posted by them in reference to me, you know, they've called me names, called me a Tamahu, and I mean, I can go on and on and on with a whole long list of all negative things. Never once have you all seen me say nothing negative about Lord Al and or Ali. In fact, early on that tape that was posted by the Osoites long time ago, of the conversation that was recorded, you know, of me and Ali talking, it was never my intention to put that out. Never. Because, again, there's rules to this. Our rule is we are never offensive, but we will defend ourselves. Meaning, if you come to attack me, be prepared to dance, because we're going to get down for us, you see. Now, but we ain't going to attack nobody. Why? Because that's not right. You see, to purposely go pick a fight, when indeed, you should be minding your business. And if you don't have nothing good to say, you shouldn't say nothing at all. You see, that's the right way. It's called diplomacy. Something that all of us, as the most powerful and beautiful nation that we are, should be not demonstrating, because we don't do that. The demonstration, to demonstrate, is a demon coming straight at you, you know. We display our power for all eyes to see. That's why this bookstore was called All Eyes on Egypt. Now, but at the same time, why do we display our power? Because if you display, that means you stand against playing. Because, you know, we have a star that the pyramids line up with called Cyrus B, which if you spell it, is Sirius B. And then put the B, you know, on the other side. Why? Because we're on the wrong side of the mirror. It would read B, Sirius. So we don't play games. or we shouldn't be. And keep in mind, they play basketball on a basketball court. They play tennis on a tennis court. By the mere fact you enter into a room called a courtroom, that should tell you that some sort of game is being played. And like I said, we show up to play ping pong. We got a paddle in our hand. They say, no, we're shooting pool. They go, wait a minute, let me go get my pool stick. You come back, they say, nah, we playing golf. And so if you don't know law, my advice is don't break none. See, because in the penitentiary, you got a lot of things you can do. You can play dominoes, spades, and or pinochle. Or you can keep your face in a book, preferably a law book like I did, okay? And because of it, I am extremely respected. Meaning, I don't care what, everybody, the Black Gorilla Family, the BGF, the Crips, the Bloods, the Nostanios and Sorrenos respected me, and I was able to cross those ethnical lines that should never been crossed, let somebody else tell it to see, but that's because I'm at Toon Ray, and this is fulfillment of prophecy. You didn't know by now. Read some of the stuff we done put out and tell me, you know, it's fabricated. Because like I said, if it is fabricated, that means it can be done. And if it can be done, that means you can do it. And to you all who say this, it is a fabrication and or a lie and that I'm a con man, then you produce the likeness thereof. You bad, because let me tell you something. That information is the hottest and baddest information that this nation has seen since May 8th of 2002, since Baba was put in the federal penitentiary. Tell the truth and shame the devil. You know it's true. But many of you ain't gonna tell me, I know, because that's hater thing. It's like a disease, because it puts you in a seat by which you are, you know, not at ease anymore, because some truth is being told that you don't like to hear, that makes you recognize some things about yourself that shouldn't be the way they are. Not in a great organization such as the one we all belong to, which should be pristine pure, but has now fell so very far. So, you know, almost to the point that many of us act like beasts. And I don't care, it is a beast mentality that is reflected by tone. It's real easy, especially for a tone-sensitive person such as myself and or deity who is named At Toon Ray. A tune, you know. But that's the only reason I didn't answer that question. I addressed the Niecy Nash issue. And again, I prove I am God merely behind the fact that he's got questions he wants to ask me. Who and what is God? God is anything or anybody who's in control. All I got to do to prove that I'm God is say no. I ain't answering nothing. And right there, that proves who's in control. He might say, well, you won't answer because you don't have the answers. I'll say, well, you'll never know. And right there again, that proves that I'm in control, because all I got to do is let him wallow in that. So that's a fact, and again, tell the truth and shame the devil.